Hi, I'm Hetty Carlson, and I am the Teacher Flight Program Manager for Wings Over the Rockies Air and Space Museum. And today we are going to be talking about navigation basics, as well as introduction to aeronautical charts. The best way to introduce charts to your students is to talk about map basics. And when I say map basics, I mean talk about longitude and latitude and relation to the globe. On our chart, we can see that we have lines of latitude, and it might be a little bit difficult to see right here. And then we have our longitudinal lines going this way. And obviously, they increase in degree from the equator, north and south. They're all measured in degrees and minutes. Another really important thing is for students to learn how to read a compass rose and learn their cardinal directions. And what I mean by cardinal directions is the number as it correlates to north, east, south, and west, such as 360 degrees, 90 degrees, 180 degrees, and west, 270 degrees. What may come as a surprise to you is that there are two North Poles. And what I mean by that is there is the true north, which is a geographical point on the globe, and it's where the axis runs from north to south. Then there's also the magnetic north, and that is basically an ore deposit that is located somewhere around the Arctic Circle. The difference between true north and magnetic north is called variation or declination. And if you look at our chart, you can see a magenta segmented line, and these are called isogonic lines. And basically, they change depending on where they are on the globe. When we talk about referencing charts or maps, we talk about true north. But pilots, when they fly an airplane, they fly in reference to magnetic north, which means they fly with a compass, so their headings are always going to be magnetic. If you look right here, 8 degrees, 15 minutes east. That means if our true course or true north direction is 360 degrees, we're going to subtract 8 degrees from that to get our magnetic heading. Now, I've been referring to maps, and I've also been referring to charts. And when I mean by a chart, I mean an aeronautical chart. And this is basically what pilots use, or VFR pilots use, for navigational purposes. So if we look at this chart, this is what's called a terminal area chart, or our TAC chart. The scale of this chart is 1 to 250,000. And we also have sectional charts. And these just kind of emphasize visual checkpoints and topographical information. Our terminal area charts are usually reissued every 6 months, but you don't want to wait 6 months before you check to make sure that there's not a supplement that has come out. So this chart was issued in January of this year, but as you can see right here, Front Range Airport, the identifier is FTG. Well, this airport is no longer called Front Range Airport. It is now Colorado Air and Spaceport. And there is also a new ICAO identifier of KCFO. Some of the information that are shown on charts are cultural, such as towns, roads, power lines, and just developments. So as you can see in our chart, we have the metropolitan area. Charts also give us geographic information, such as topography, elevation, rivers and lakes. So as you can see right here, we have Aurora Reservoir. Out here we have the Cherry Creek Reservoir, as well as the Cherry Creek Dam. And it gives you a good reference for that and where it is in relation to Centennial Airport. Our chart gives us airspace information, such as around Centennial Airport. We have a dashed blue line, which represents Class Delta airspace. And we also have down here, nautical miles, statute miles, and kilometers, just for reference. One of the greatest things about aeronautic charts is if you ever have any questions about something that you don't recognize or unfamiliar with, you can always flip back to the other side and look at the legend here, and it has some great information on here as well. Another really fun thing to do with students is to have them just find airports on the chart. For example, we have Centennial Airport right here, and that's where we are located right now at the exploration of flight. We also have Front Range Airport, which is actually very close to Denver International Airport, and pretty much everyone knows where Denver International Airport is. And then over here to our west, we have Rocky Mountain Metropolitan Airport. One of the last things we're going to talk about is our airport data block. And basically, our airport data block gives us information about the airport without ever having to look elsewhere. So if we look at our first data block, we're going to look at Centennial Airport. And if you notice here, there's a star right above the east-west runway, which notates that this airport has a rotating beacon. It also gives you the general area of where the tower is. The identifier is APA. That's the ICAO identifier, which is the International Civil Aviation Organization. And all the airports in the world have their own identifiers. We use K in front of all of our identifiers for the United States. If you look at the second line, it says CT. That means this has a control tower. The frequency for our control tower is 118.9. It also has an ATIS, or an Automated Terminal Information System. On the third line, we have our elevation of the airport, so 5,885 feet. The L stands for lighting, which means that this airport is lit, and because there is no star, and if we want to look at a star, we can look over at Front Range Airport. The L, or before the L, we have a star, which means that it's only a part-time tower, which means that the lighting has to be controlled by the pilot when they come in. If there are no lights, they usually use their microphone to click 3, 5, or 7 times, depending on the intensity of lights. The next number is the length of the longest runway at this airport. For Centennial Airport, our longest runway is 10,000 feet. So this is given in hundreds of feet, so 100 times 100 is 10,000. And then right here, we also have 122.95, which is going to be our CTAF or UNICOM frequency. So if there's not enough information, or if we want more information, we have our handy dandy airport directory. This is, of course, my favorite airport directory. It is put out by CDOT Division of Aeronautics. The great thing about this is if you turn to any of the airports in here, it gives you a color picture, and it's an aerial picture of what that airport looks like. So as you're flying in, you have a visual reference as well. It also gives you information about latitude, longitude, elevation, any navigational aids, such as our VORs or GPS, ILS, which is something that we don't need to worry about today. It also gives us information about runways, length, whether or not this airport has any services, such as fuel. Places that you can find aeronautical charts so that you can let your students look at them and study them and just kind of get a good introduction to them is going to your local fixed-based operator or going to the FAA.gov website, and they have free downloadable links. Another really good website, VFRmap.com, which is great for just viewing charts and for training. And then there's also SkyVector. SkyVector.com is great for flight planning abilities. And you can actually do that with a digital map or a digital chart. So in conclusion today, we talked about maps and charts and some of the similarities and some of the differences, what kinds of charts that VFR or visual flight rule pilots use for navigational reference. Next time, we'll be talking about airspace classification.